About 100 years ago, astronomers Edwin Hubble and Georges Lemaître made the incredible discovery that our universe is expanding. They saw that all the galaxies in the universe were moving away from each other. You can think of this expansion as being similar to a loaf of bread rising. As the dough expands, it will carry nuts or raisins inside the bread away from each other. In a similar way, as space expands, it carries galaxies away from each other. Because of Hubble's discovery, we call the rate of the expansion of the universe the Hubble constant, represented by H0. So how do astronomers measure H0?
To measure the expansion rate, you need to make measurements of objects in space that are far away from us, so it has to be an object that's very bright in order to be able to observe it. There's a special type of supernova, an exploding star, that we can use to make this measurement. These supernovae give off a lot of energy, so we can see them even at large distances if we have a telescope that's powerful enough. As it turns out, the Hubble Space Telescope, named after Edwin Hubble, can make this measurement by taking very sharp and very deep images of these distant supernovae. Astronomers have been able to measure H0 very precisely using these observations.
But if the universe is expanding, that means that in the past, all of the galaxies must have been closer together. And if you go back in time far enough, everything must have been concentrated into a very small and dense region. From this very small region, space must have expanded very quickly in an event we call the Big Bang. Just after the Big Bang, the universe was very hot and dense. It turns out that we can still see the light from this very early time in the universe today. That light from the early universe looks like this. But this doesn't look like anything we can see in the sky, does it? The reason we can't see the light from the early universe with our eyes is because that light can only be seen as microwave radiation. We need a special instrument in order to see microwaves. A decade ago, astronomers launched a satellite called Planck, which was designed for just this purpose. Planck takes images of the sky in microwaves, similar to how the Hubble Space Telescope takes images in optical light. And this light from the early universe, which we call the Cosmic Microwave Background, or CMB for short, is what it observed.
The CMB has a very uniform temperature, but when we measure it with very sensitive instruments, we see that it has several spots which are slightly hotter or slightly colder, as shown in this image with red and blue regions. These correspond to regions of the early universe that had either slightly higher or slightly lower density compared to the typical density of the universe at the time. It turns out that the pattern of hot and cold spots can give us a lot of information. We have different theories and models about the universe and what its properties are, and different models would give different patterns in the CMB. By looking at the actual CMB, we can figure out which of these models best describes the real universe. For example, the scale of these patterns is set by the geometry of the universe, either flat or curved. From the very detailed images of the CMB taken by Planck, astronomers have been able to precisely predict the value of the Hubble constant based on the model that best fits the data.
So astronomers have these two ways to calculate H0, from observations of supernovae and from observations of the CMB. But a problem has come about in recent years as the measurements have become more precise. These two methods don't agree with each other.
The value of H0 calculated by Planck's observations of the CMB is smaller than the value calculated at present from the supernova observations by about 10%, and we don't know why this is. These error bars around each measurement represent the likely range of the measurements. As you can see, the distance between these measurements is larger than can be explained by their uncertainties. There could be a problem with one or both of these methods, but both groups of astronomers have checked the results and are confident that they are doing things correctly. A more exciting possibility is that there is something new about physics which we don't understand yet, but which is the real cause of this discrepancy.
The disagreement between the two methods of measuring H0 has generated a lot of excitement, but also debate among astronomers. While there is no resolution yet, what seems to be clear is that we need alternate methods of determining H0 to provide an independent measurement. By using new methods based on completely different observations, which do not use the CMB or supernovae, we can make sure that unknown errors that might potentially have affected one or both of these two methods are unlikely to affect the new independent method. One such method is based upon a phenomenon called gravitational lensing. Viewed through a telescope, galaxies that are very far away from Earth appear very small in the sky, while nearby galaxies appear much larger. But what happens if a nearby galaxy happens to be directly in between us and a more distant galaxy behind it?
When you get this chance alignment of a large galaxy and a more distant object directly behind it, the foreground galaxy does not just obstruct the view to the background galaxy. In fact, the gravity from the nearby galaxy, which we call the lens, can bend the light rays coming from the faraway object, which we call the source. What happens then is that the image of the source can become magnified and warped. And in some cases, we can see two or four different images of the source. This is what we call gravitational lensing. The lensing effect depends on the mass of the lens. If the lens is more massive, the light rays from the source get deflected by a larger amount. And if the lens is less massive, the light rays get deflected by a smaller amount. So this changes the path that the light rays take from the background source to us here on Earth. Since the paths that the light rays take through space are different, what happens is that two light rays that get emitted from the source at the same time can arrive at Earth at different times. And this difference in arrival time is what we call the time delay of the lens. One way to think about this effect is by comparing it to different train lines that start and end at similar places. For example, let's say you have two trains going from Shinjuku to Tokyo Station. One of them is on the Yamanote line and the other is on the Kyō line. Even if both trains leave Shinjuku at the same time and move at the same speed, they're going to take different paths and will stop at a different number of stations, so they will arrive at Tokyo Station at different times. This is analogous to light rays traveling from the source to Earth along different paths. One of them is going to arrive before the other.
The time delay depends on the deflection of the light rays caused by gravitational lensing, but it also depends on H0, since the distance between us, the lens, and the source depends on how much the universe has expanded in the time it took those light rays to reach us. So if we can accurately measure the time delay and gravitational effect of the lens, we can determine H0 in a way that is independent from the CMB and supernova.
But in order to make use of this method, astronomers first need to measure the time delay of a lens. So how do they do this?
We've been using small telescopes to observe and monitor gravitational lenses over time. We are looking for small changes in the surface brightness of the lens image that happen one after the other due to the time delay effect. By monitoring these lenses over several years, we can accurately determine the time delay.
This effort to measure time delays requires using many telescopes all over the world, as well as a dedicated team of astronomers to conduct the observations over many years.
Our project for measuring time delays is called Cosmological Monitoring of Gravitational Lenses. And one thing about astronomers is we like to come up with catchy acronyms for naming our project. So rather than say the entire name, we shorten this to COSMOGRAIL.
COSMOGRAIL has been able to measure time delays for several gravitational lenses. But in order to determine H0, we still need to know the strength of the deflection of light rays due to the gravity of the lens. Determining this requires very sharp images from a very powerful telescope.
The Hubble Space Telescope is the best telescope to use for getting detailed images. Because the telescope is located in space, we don't have to worry about the blurring of the images due to Earth's atmosphere. So we can take very sharp, very deep images of gravitational lenses. These images allow us to make accurate calculations of the strength of the gravitational effect of the lens. We can then combine the time delays measured by COSMOGRAIL with our calculation based on the Hubble Space Telescope imaging to determine the Hubble constant.
But there is a complicating factor. This simple picture of gravitational lensing does not take into account that there are other galaxies along the line of sight, and those other galaxies can affect the light rays as well.
We need to account for galaxies along the line of sight, so what we do is to take a much wider image of the region around the lens. We can then compare the distribution of galaxies around the lens to what we would expect based on large computer simulations of the universe. From these simulations, we can correct for the effect of galaxies along the line of sight in a statistical way.
The combination of these efforts, measuring time delays, measuring the strength of the lensing effect, and correcting for galaxies along the line of sight, has required a large collaborative effort involving astronomers all over the world. And of course, this large project needs its own name.
Since we're building on the time delays measured by COSMOGRAIL, we call our project H0 Lenses in COSMOGRAIL's Wellspring, or its acronym, HOLY COW!
We recently finished analyzing a total of 6 gravitational lenses. From these 6, we've been able to measure the Hubble constant very precisely. Here, we saw that the value of H0 calculated from the CMB was smaller than the value calculated from supernovae. Now, with HOLY COW, we have an independent measurement of H0 and what we find is a result that is larger than the CMB value, but agrees well with the supernova measurement. Based on the distance between our measurement and the one from the CMB, as well as on the size of the error bars, we estimate that there's only about a 1 in 300 chance of this result being so far away from the CMB result. An interesting thing is that the CMB provides a measurement of H0 from the early universe, just after the Big Bang. On the other hand, the supernova and H0LiCOW results are both measurements of H0 that come from the late universe, or at least a much longer time after the Big Bang. If we combine our result with the supernova result, we find that the chance of this combined result being so different from the CMB result is about 1 in 10 million.
This disagreement between early and late universe measurements of H0 currently presents a mystery for astronomers. What could be causing this discrepancy?
The most boring answer would be some sort of error that hasn't been properly accounted for in one or more of the different methods of calculating H0. These measurements can be tricky, and it can be hard to make sure you've accounted for everything that could possibly go wrong with your experiment. You especially have to be careful about what some people call the unknown unknowns. But now, with multiple independent measurements, it seems that there isn't any single unknown that can explain all the different measurements and why they disagree.
A more interesting answer would be that our current understanding of the universe is incomplete, and that this discrepancy is pointing us towards some sort of new physics that we haven't discovered yet. We don't know what this new physics might be yet, although there are a lot of theories out there. But it seems likely that it will require some sort of change in the physical properties between the early and late universe.
As we get more data and analyze more gravitational lenses, our measurement will get more precise. This will allow us to rule out certain sources of error and to eventually be able to say conclusively whether this discrepancy is real.
If the disagreement between the different measurements of the expansion rate from the early and late universe persists, it could lead to exciting new discoveries about the fundamental nature of our universe. Until then, the various teams of astronomers, including H0LiCOW, will be tirelessly working to make more as well as more precise observations in order to solve this problem.